The psalmist writes in Psalm 118, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever." Well, the beginning verse there, verse 26, are the words that the crowd in Jerusalem is yelling out as Jesus rides in on Palm Sunday when they say, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." So I welcome you this morning, this Palm Sunday, where we too celebrate the fact that Jesus came to Jerusalem. He came to that city for the purpose of being the Savior, to the ransom for our sins. Well, this morning, just want to draw your attention to a few announcements. First, big congratulations to Roy and Jody Burdett on the birth of their first grandchild. Now, you may have thought from Roy's beard, he's been taking that grandchild, that look pretty seriously for a while now, but he's going to be, I'm sure, a great grandpa. I don't see, where's Jody at? Is she in here? Oh, she's hiding. Oh, there she is. Okay, well, congratulations, Roy and Jody. Their son Nathan and his wife gave birth to little Natalie Mae Burdett last Sunday morning. So congratulations to you guys. Also, just want to make you aware, this coming Sunday, of course, is Easter Sunday. During our Sunday school hour, which is 9:30, we're going to have like a morning brunch, or I guess you could breakfast, whatever you want to call it. It'll be pancakes and eggs, probably have coffee and drinks. So encourage you, even if you don't normally come for the Sunday school hour, it's a great chance to come, get some food, and just enjoy a time of fellowship with each other before the service begins at 7:45. Also, on Friday evening, we do a joint Good Friday service with other Alliance churches in the area. And so that'll start at 6 p.m. Friday night, this coming Friday. And after that, there will be a meal to follow. And so you're welcome to stay for the meal and enjoy just fellowship with people from other churches in the area. Special thank you. I know a number of you have signed up to volunteer for part of that. So just appreciate your willingness to serve in that way. Also, I meant to mention this in conjunction to Easter Sunday. We do have these envelopes in the back. I mentioned last week that we do this 30 pieces of silver offering where you can, there's a letter in there kind of explains what it is, where it's just a special offering we take. It's going to be given for outreach purposes. Obviously, 30 pieces of silver is what Judas accepted as he betrayed Jesus. So it's a way of kind of redeeming that 30 pieces of silver, so to speak. So you can take that if you feel led to give that. You can there's a little bag in there. You can put whatever money you want in that envelope. You can bring it to church or to Sunday school and give that, and that'll be money designated for some outreach things that we'll be doing later on in the year. Also, last week we had our chili cook-off, so thanks to the guys who set that up. I think there were a few different winners. I can't remember who all they were, but I had a lot of chilies. It was delicious, so thank you to everybody who participated. I heard that the men actually did an acceptable job cleaning the kitchen, so it was said with shock and surprise. I'm not sure why, but thanks to the guys for cleaning up. Also, I think there are a few dishes that have been left either from that or other times, so if you're missing a dish or if you see a dish out there that's been sitting there a few weeks, it's fair game, I'm pretty sure, so don't forget your dish or claim that if you don't want it to disappear. So thanks for everybody who helped out with that. This afternoon we have youth group for the middle schoolers and high schoolers that are here, so be here at 5 o'clock. Also, I want to make you aware, this Wednesday we have like a special opportunity. Our denomination, the Christian Missionary Alliance, we have missionaries all over the world, but we have a team in the Middle East, and they're launching a new team into a new city. And I don't want to say because we're being streamed here, but it's in a very sensitive area. And we have had these couples come through our church several times, and we're well connected with them. So on Wednesday night, you're being invited. There's going to be a live webinar event, and we're going to host that here at the church. It'll be people all over the country participating. But it's an opportunity to hear about this brand new work that they're starting in a new city. The people we had 2 years ago, if you remember, came through. They're actually going to be the couple or the family that's leading this new team. So I just want to encourage you, if that's something that's on your heart or your mind, or you want to find out more about this new work in the Middle East or how you can pray, or if there's another way you want to engage with that. It starts at 7 p.m. Be here at 7 p.m. It starts a little bit after that, but I want to give you time to be here because we're not the ones in control of the timing, so it's going to start promptly at 7:30 is when the video starts, but we're going to have a time of prayer a little bit before then. So I encourage you to consider coming to that on Wednesday night if you're able to do that. And we're nearing the end, I promise. The Walk for Life, which is part of Akron Pregnancy Services, is in May. May 20th, it's an organization I like for us to support, and so just want to put that on your calendar if that's something you want to mark down. I'll get you more information, but it's a way to support them, and you kind of raise money and take part of this walk, and it goes to support the many things they do to help young men and women, or sorry, women and men, I should say, who have maybe unplanned pregnancies. So, okay, that was a lot for this morning. Well, I want to just turn to the Gospel of John as we prepare our hearts to sing again. I just read for you that psalm, Psalm 118, and here is that account in the Gospel of John. It says, "The next day a large crowd had gathered, had come to feast, and heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees, and they went out to meet him, crying, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel.'" Well, would you stand with us this morning as we have a chance to sing together and to sing praises of blessing to the Lord. Well, would you take a minute and just welcome those who are standing near you this morning and welcome each other here on this Palm Sunday. At the same time, the children can be dismissed for Children's Church. Yeah. All right, if you can work your way back to your seats this morning. And once you find your way back to your seat, feel free to just go ahead and be seated. And I'm going to just take a minute to pray for our offering this morning. Lord, we are gathered here this morning and we just sang these words, the wonderful cross. And as we sing those words, Lord, may it be true of us that we indeed see the cross as wonderful, even though the very meaning of the cross calls for us to give our life, Lord, in service to you. It is wonderful news that our sins are paid for, that we are forgiven because of what Jesus has done on that cross. And Lord, as we give to you this morning, would our hearts just reflect the reality of what it means to be redeemed and to be rescued out of a life of sin. Would you be glorified in Jesus' name? Amen.
This morning's scripture reading is going to be in Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. And this is the final chapter, right, Pastor? We are in the final chapter of Mark. There's just so much to learn from this book of the Bible, so we've appreciated all the messages. So Mark 16, 1 through 8. And if you have a pew Bible in the New Testament, it's page 42. It says, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might come and anoint him. Very early on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb where the sun had risen. When they were saying to one another, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? Looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, although it was extremely large. Entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting at the right, wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. And he said to them, do not be amazed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who has been crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold, here is the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. They went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment and had gripped them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your word, and Lord, just for the resurrection that we're learning about. And Father, that's the reason we can even stand before you. And Lord, we know that without this gift of salvation, without Jesus paying the debt, that there's no way we could earn our way into heaven, that there's nothing we could do to deserve it. And Lord, we just ask for the miracle of grace and faith and belief for anybody who has not accepted you, Lord. and we're going to trust you for the outcomes. And Lord, just open our hearts and our minds to what Pastor has to say and speak to us directly with the Holy Spirit. It's here in your name we pray. Amen.
Well, you may not all share the sentiment of a bittersweetness of coming to the end of Mark. Maybe some of you have been hoping for this for months now, but it is, I think, bittersweet for me to realize that we have come to the end of a long journey. It's been over a year and a half that we've been walking through the Gospel of Mark, and in some senses, the stories that we've heard and read are very familiar to us, yet at the same time, there's a lot in there that we just easily look over when we're reading. And it's been good for my own heart and my own soul as we've kind of slowed down a little bit to look at the implications of what Mark has recorded for us in his gospel. And as we come to the end of Mark, it's a bit of a tough ending, to be honest. I don't know if you've ever watched a movie or a show where you just really enjoy the show or the movie, and all of a sudden you come to the end of the whatever it is, the show or movie, and you go, wow, that was kind of a disappointment. I don't know if you, have you ever had that experience? It seems like every time my wife has a show that we enjoy, I say my wife because really she controls what we get to enjoy when it comes to a show. Usually it doesn't involve lots of violence and things like that. And so anyway, every show we start to enjoy, all of a sudden, about the end of season one or season two, it's like one of the main characters just all of a sudden at the end of the episodes, boom, he just drops dead for some reason. It's not a violent show, but they have to do that. And it's because there's contract disputes. I don't know. They have to kill off these main characters. And it always just changes. It's just a disappointment, right? It changes the whole outcome of the rest of the show. And they try to bring some new person in. Usually it's some guy, you know, that another man for the lady or whatever. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about. Well, you've been there before. And I bring that up because in the course of history, the ending of the Gospel of Mark has always been difficult to understand. So I'm just going to give you a little bit of history here, and this might feel laborsome, but I think it's important for us to look at this briefly before we really dig into verses 1 through 8. So in the course of history, there's been really two main endings for the Gospel of Mark. If you look in your Bible, you have the NASB, I don't know if you have the ESV, whatever it might be. If you look at verses 9 through 20, your Bible may not even have them included. If it does have them included, it's probably bracketed, or there's probably some sort of line with a notation saying something to the effect of the following verses, verses 9 through 20, are not found in the most early manuscripts, or something of that nature. If you have a study Bible, most study Bibles don't include it in the text, but they'll have it footnoted at the bottom of the text. So there's really sort of two endings traditionally in the Gospel of Mark, and they call this verses 9 through 20 the long ending. And verse 8 is what is often considered basically the short ending of the Gospel of Mark. So I'm not wanting to throw us too far into the weeds here, but I want us to kind of understand why are there these two possible endings to the Gospel of Mark. One commentator wrote this, which was not encouraging for my soul. He said, the Gospel of Mark, the ending of Mark, is probably one of the most difficult textual challenges in all of the New Testament. And what he means is in all of the New Testament, it's one of the most difficult texts to understand exactly if it should or should not be included as part of the gospel itself as a whole. Now, for our purpose this morning, I'm going to suggest, and I'm going to explain this in a moment, that you should treat the Gospel of Mark as ending at the end of verse 8, as it probably is written in your Bible. Now, the reason why there's been so many controversies over this is because of the way in which Mark 16:8 ends. It's quite unusual, to say the least. Now, I will say this position of ending the Gospel of Mark at verse 8 is the position that the majority of conservative scholars take today and have over the course of history. But I want to ask this morning, why is there possibly this second ending to Mark? As a kid, I did not like reading, but about the only book my mom could get me to read were these books where you could go and you would read, and it would be like, you could choose, right? From this page, you could either choose, do you want to go off the cliff, or do you want to go here, you know? And for me, I was trying to have foresight, like, all right, which one's going to end this book quicker? Off the cliff, you know, type of thing. And you got to keep making these decisions. Is that what it is? Like, Mark's like one of these, you just decide which ending's better for you. You know, verses 9 through 20, there's some unusual things. If you want to deal with snake handling and poison and things like that, do you choose verses 9 through 20 and just go whichever way you want? Well, no, I don't think that's the way this works. In short, I would say this. Mark 16, verse 8 has often been viewed as very abrupt. You go through this long gospel account, and suddenly it just ends, seemingly in an instant. It seems difficult to think, for many people, that Mark would just end his gospel in that way. There's no real announcement of Jesus' resurrection appearances like the other gospel accounts. Instead, you see an announcement of his resurrection, and then you see his followers, or some of them, cowering in fear. Why doesn't he include some of these other things that Matthew and Luke and John include? So because of the abruptness of the ending of Mark, it seems most likely that around the time of the second century, some of the scribes made some sort of additional comments to try and bring clarity to what maybe Mark would have said. Maybe that's something he would have said, because some people would view, and this is kind of one view here, some people look at the ending of Mark, and there's really two options you could take. You could say at Mark 16:8, it's not the actual ending, but something happened there. Something either happened to Mark, like maybe he died, maybe he was in prison, maybe there was something that limited him from finishing the writing of his book, or perhaps that original ending that Mark wrote out was somehow lost along the way. Somehow damaged the document, the original document was damaged and cut off or something, and so we don't have the actual ending of the Gospel of Mark. So that's one interpretation people would take, one option people would take here, is that the document was damaged or the disciple was damaged, right? And so Mark 16:8 seems rather abrupt. And because of that, you have these scribal additions trying to explain maybe what Mark would have said. Or the other option, and this is the one that I gravitate towards, that seems to be more consistent here with all of the Gospel of Mark, is that Mark intended his gospel in this way very purposefully. This is exactly how Mark wanted his gospel to end. He wants it to end in an abrupt manner. And if we look at this, we'll see it's rather consistent with Mark's style in which he writes all of his gospel. Everything is really matter-of-fact, very abrupt. There's a lot of things that don't make sense in the way in which he writes. You want to get more detail. What do you mean by that, Mark? I think immediately of that account we looked a while back when he was in the garden. Remember, his disciples flee, and he includes that random detail of the guy who even flees without his clothes, this weird verse to us. But as we look at it, you realize more and more there's this reality that disciple represents all of his disciples who were leaving at all costs, right? They're abandoning Jesus there. So it's not uncommon in Mark's gospel to include these somewhat abrupt scenes that just end like that. So let me just say this for you this morning, and this is the position I'm going to try to start from and work from, and for you to maybe think of, is that Mark 16:8 is the intended ending of the Gospel of Mark, and so that's how we're going to treat this final section of the Gospel according to Mark. So just a little recap of getting to where we are in this message. A few weeks back, we looked at the death of Jesus on the cross, and we saw that climactic scene where Jesus was crucified on the cross, and you had the centurion soldier, the very person who was in charge of his execution. Just as Jesus dies, he makes that claim, "Truly, this man, Jesus, is the Son of God." Do you remember that statement? We noted that for this centurion soldier to make a statement like that, Essentially, it was for him to be stating, this man, not Caesar, not the guy who in which I swear my allegiance to, who they often thought was divine at the time, it's this man, not Caesar, who is indeed the Son of God. It was a statement that would have put him next on the execution list had the right people heard him saying that. So we see that declaration that Jesus is the Son of God, and then immediately after that, we went to the scene where Jesus is taken and he's buried into the tomb. Is that me? Am I destroying stuff here? Okay. Sorry. Jesus is taken, he's put in the tomb, and it's Joseph of Arimathea, and he takes Jesus and he goes to Pilate and he asks for special permission to take Jesus and put him in his tomb. Now, if you remember, crucifixion was a punishment for the person, but it was more than just a punishment. It was a public display for everybody to see that if you disobey the Roman rules, if you're going to go against Caesar, you're going to pay the price. And they wanted everybody to see what would happen to somebody who did that. And so it was customary that if you died on the cross, you hung on the cross. And your body was left on the cross to decay and to rot for everybody to see. So there's somewhat of a special permission given here to Joseph. But when Joseph goes to Pilate to ask for the body of Jesus, Pilate himself is actually surprised. Wow, he's dead already is sort of the response he gives. And he calls to his executioner, to the centurion soldier, to verify that Jesus indeed is dead. And it's confirmed. Jesus is dead, without a doubt. These guys are the experts of death by crucifixion, and they are certain that Jesus is dead. Now, why do I say that over and over? Because over the course of history, many have posited and said that, oh, maybe Jesus didn't actually die when he was buried and put in the tomb. He was just, you know, he just fainted and passed out. But that's not the case here. In that scene, we have these three women, Mary, Magdalene, Mary, the son of James, or the mother of James, I'm sorry, and Salome, and they witness Jesus' death on the cross. And then both Marys are listed in the last verse of chapter 15. It says, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were looking on to see where he was laid, where he was buried. And that leads us into our story, our text this morning, chapter 16, the ending of Mark, the resurrection scene. So let's look there together. Verse 1 of chapter 16 says this, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might come and anoint him. Now, he specifies here when the Sabbath was over. You remember when Jesus was when he was crucified? It was on that Friday night, right before sunset, because at sunset was when the Sabbath begun. And so it was right before sunset. Jesus dies and is put into the tomb, and they can't do anything during the Sabbath, right? So now Sabbath is over. As soon as the sun rises, the Sabbath is over on Sunday morning. And so these women, they get some spices, and they go and they head to the tomb. Now, just so you are aware, most scholars believe that it was Sunday, the 5th of April in the year of AD 33 that this actually happened. Most likely, that's the actual day and the actual year in which Jesus rose from the grave. So you have these three women, they take spices and they go to anoint him. Well, what are they doing? Why are they anointing Jesus? Didn't Joseph actually already do that when he buried Jesus, when he put him in the tomb? Likely he did. But these women do this in order to honor Jesus. It's a way of honoring him and honoring his body. It's also part of the Jewish burial custom. They would take spices, they would put it over the body, and it basically was a perfume that was used to kind of mask the stench of the rotting flesh. That was sort of a way of honoring the dead person. They didn't necessarily deal with bodies in the same way that we would today. So that's what they're going to do. Jesus is dead. They know he's dead. They're headed to the tomb to honor his dead body. There's no doubt in their minds that he is indeed dead. Well, who were these women exactly? We've mentioned this a little bit a couple weeks ago, and what specifically is their significance? The first time we see these women mentioned was at the cross, where they were there in the background witnessing Jesus' death, and they're mentioned again at his burial and here for a final time in the final scene of the Gospel of Mark, at one of the most crucial moments in the entire Gospel, where Jesus' body is raised, where his tomb is empty, It's these three women. These three women that seem to have no significant role in the whole rest of the gospel. Why is that? What is their significance? Well, we mentioned this a couple weeks ago, and I just want to remind you. First, these women are mentioned by name by Mark, and that's very unusual. Throughout the entire Gospel of Mark, he rarely, if ever, mentions people by name, let alone a woman. And the reason he does this is because it attests to the significance of their eyewitness account of what is happening in the resurrection scene. If this story were to be fabricated, if for some reason the early church wanted to make up a story of what had happened to Jesus because, you know, he was supposed to rise from the dead and their leader was killed, so they had to do something to make it look like he rose from the dead, you would not choose women to be your eyewitness accounts. Judaism, like all cultures at the time, saw women as one of the lowest rungs of society. To be a woman is the same as being a slave, essentially. Women and children, they were treated terribly in all cultures at the time. You would not choose women. In fact, it was against the Jewish law to even accept the testimony of a woman. So both Roman culture, Jewish culture, saw little to no value in women. Quite simply, these women would not be chosen to be eyewitnesses if this were a made-up story, right? In fact, 2 centuries later, there was a powerful, influential leader. I don't know what I'm doing here. I'll put it here. Maybe I'm fiddling with it on accident. All right. There was this man named Celsus, and he actually would poke and make fun of the Christians. And this is what he would say, that your religion depends on the gossip of women, right? So even 2 centuries later, women were still devalued and still thought to be of little importance. And so he would make fun of Christians because their whole religion was based off of the eyewitness account of women. If you look in these first, in all of these verses, all 8 of these verses, you would see this, the them, right? They. It's repeated over and over and over, this direct reference to these three ladies. You can't help but notice how important they are in this scene. So it's no doubt that these three ladies, Mary, and Salome, were and are significant. They are significant eyewitnesses of the empty tomb. I'm going to make a point here in a second, but I just want to state this again. This is a side note. I did this a couple weeks ago, but I just think it's important for us to understand that Jesus highly valued women. He highly valued children. He highly valued people who are the most vulnerable in society. That's what Jesus did in his ministry. It was the example he set. He cared about all people. Now, these women were without a doubt disciples of Jesus. They were followers of Jesus. At that time, no Jewish rabbi would have had women followers. It was very countercultural for a leader, a teacher, a rabbi to do something like that. Jesus highly valued women. And I said this before, and I think it's true here, that it's no different for us, right, today in our church. Not just women, not just children, but the most vulnerable people of society ought to be highly valued by the church. However, and I'm going to make this point, I'll explain why in a moment, Jesus reinforces in the way he does ministry. We see this back in Mark chapter 3 when Jesus calls the 12 and calls them to be apostles. He takes these 12 men and he sets them aside to essentially be the leaders. They will essentially become the leaders of the early church. They are these 12 people specifically set aside to follow Jesus everywhere he goes. They receive special teaching, special instructions, and they are given kind of a special authority over leadership within the body of Christ. Now, I make note of that because for 2,000 years, it has been a guiding biblical principle that essentially this: men and women are of equal value to God. Yet within the church and within the family, men and women are given distinct roles. I'll say more on that in just a second. The reason why I'm bringing this up again is because this section of Scripture right here that we are looking at is a section of scripture that is used and has been used very recently by a number of pastors and churches to basically argue and to say that Jesus' model was that women were to preach and to be pastors. And they do that by seeing this passage and saying Jesus' first commission was to ladies. When he was resurrected, the first thing he did is he appeared to these women or through this messenger, and it was the women who were called to preach to the men, is sort of the argument that's given there. In fact, just recently, if you follow church politics or church news, the Southern Baptist Convention, which is a conservative evangelical organization, they voted to basically kick out 6 churches from being part of their fellowship within their denomination because they were routinely and consistently going against this position that there is a distinct role for men and women in the church, specifically that the role of pastor and elder, which is the same role, is one that is reserved for men, biblically by God. Not just any man, but biblically qualified men. So not just merely a man makes you qualified for that. I just want to make that clear. One particular church that's well known is Saddleback Church. It's a mega church that's pastored by, or was pastored by Rick Warren, a very well known author. And they were one of the churches that made this switch and were asked to leave the denomination. And I just use this to point out, I want to say that I think Rick Warren is a guy who has faithfully served the Lord. I'm not trying to say that he's not a follower of Jesus, but I would disagree with his position here. Because in an interview, he was asked, what is it that led to your change of position? Where there's scripture passages that clearly teach on how the leadership in the church is to work and is to function, is to be set up. And this was one of the main texts that he points to of changing his position. And it was this very argument that he sees that men were given this role to preach. Sorry, women were given this role to preach to men. So I bring it up today because this is not the point of the text at all. I think the point here is that women do matter to God and that they should be highly valued. But I don't think you can draw out from this text that somehow women ought to be pastors or elders. In fact, I think you have to do a lot of biblical gymnastics, I will say, to get to that position. And so I say that almost as just a way of caution this morning. If you hear arguments like that, you understand what's going on here, and that's not the main point of this text. In fact, a lot of it points to culture at the time. They'll say, well, Jesus was countercultural and recognized women, and that's very true. He was. Jesus valued women in a way the culture did not. And I firmly believe that Scripture gives testimony to the equal value of men and women. But I would say this, by God's design, both men and women are given these distinct, different roles, specifically pertaining to leadership of both the family and the church. And those roles are not roles of greater or lesser value. Let me just emphasize, it's not a role of greater value versus lesser value, but they're different, distinct roles by God's design for the purpose of leadership in the church and the family. Now, I'm not going to say more on that because this is not a text to draw that out from, but I just want you to know that Jesus is teaching what Jesus models, emphasizes and reemphasizes that very biblical principle. So I'm just going to close that there and leave it there. But here's some important thing to take away that I think is the major significance of these 3 eyewitnesses, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of Joseph, and Salome. These 3 women that show up to the empty tomb, they are, in fact, women, and that is significant. It is countercultural. It is very much a fact that gives authenticity of the events of Jesus's resurrection. His death, his burial, his resurrection, they are the ones listed who see every single thing. They are the eyewitness account. Just look at verse 2 here. It says, very early on the first day of the week, these 3 women, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. There's a few little details here. It emphasizes it was very early and it was when the sun had risen. It's making clear exactly when it was. It was that Sunday morning, just after the sun had risen, they go, the first chance they get, to go to the tomb. They go so that they can anoint Jesus' body. Now, why does it specify the time? Well, news flash, right? They didn't have Apple Watches or cell phones to tell them exactly what time it was. You knew the time of day, time because of where the sun was. Was it early in the morning? Was it midday? Was it afternoon? There were different aspects. So it's an eyewitness account, right? This is a historical record. This is an event that actually happened. This isn't made up. It's not falsified. This is a real life event. It gives credibility to the eyewitness account. Verse 3 says, they were saying to one another, who will roll the stone away for us from the entrance of the tomb? They asked this question, maybe a nervous question, on the way, realizing, hey, there's a giant stone there. How on earth are we going to move that thing? Now, maybe the question we should be asking is, where are the men, right? Maybe shouldn't the men be with them saying, hey, we can help roll that stone away, but they're nowhere to be seen. Jesus is 12 apostles, all the closest disciples to him, these men who've been with him every step of the way, they're absent. They're not there. Their leader was just crucified, and what are they doing? They're cowering and hiding. They're afraid. But here's these women headed there, wondering how they're going to get the stone rolled away. But there's something else important here to realize. They're headed there, but there's a reality that they do not in any way anticipate or expect that Jesus will be raised from the dead. Do you realize that? They've been told this, right? All the disciples, all the followers of Jesus have been told this multiple times by Jesus. I'm going to die, and what's going to happen? I'm going to rise again 3 days later. They've been told over and over this very message. And here it's happened, and everything Jesus has said has come to fruition, has been fulfilled, and yet they're still heading to the tomb with zero expectation of finding a resurrected Lord. Verse 4 says, looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, although it was extremely large. So the stone is rolled away to their amazement. And just note here, there's kind of an indication in the way it's written. There's no man that moved this stone. There's no person that rolled the stone away. It was the work of God that rolled that stone away. It was God who caused the stone to roll away. It was God who is involved in this whole process, right? One writer says this, the human role of the event of the resurrection is simply that we are a witness and not a worker. We will see this call to be a witness further in verse chapter 8. It's the same call that's given to us as well. But the stone is rolled away. Verse 5, entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting at the right wearing a white robe, and they were amazed. Well, what does it mean that they're amazed? Now, when we use the word amazement, usually we're thinking like, wow, that's super cool, right? That maybe that's how I think of amazement, but that's not exactly what it means here. It means more of a breathtaking, unable to respond, an astonished type of amazement. There's both fear and wonder in this type of an amazement. That's actually the Greek translation of that word. It's an astonishment and a distress at the same time. They are full of astonishment and they are full of distress because of what is happening. It's not something of human origin in front of them. They know that. They see that. They understand that something unique, something almost unbelievable is happening here. In fact, it's something divine that's happening. Again, just note, they still fully don't expect for Jesus to be raised. They fully expect to find Jesus as dead as he was when he was put in the tomb. He predicted it, but they didn't expect it. The reality is that the resurrection was just as foreign to them as it is to you and to me. Now, if you're like me, you grew up hearing about the resurrection. If you went to church at all, you know what the resurrection is. And we embrace it, but I think internally, oftentimes, don't we sit there and think, that's almost sounds a bit outlandish, doesn't it? Because we don't see people buried, put in a tomb, and 3 days later come back to life. It just does not happen. It was unexpected for them, just as it is for us. Verse 6, and he said to them, do not be amazed, you're looking for Jesus the Nazarene. He has been crucified. He has risen. He is not here. Behold, he is in the place. He is not here. Behold, here is the place where they laid him. Well, what are the words of this divine messenger? Often we think of as an angel. An angel is a messenger of the Lord who gives a message of the Lord. What does he say? He says, do not be amazed. Don't be afraid, right? Don't be distressed. Don't be astonished. In a sense, it's like he's calling them to snap out of it. Like, hey, wake up. Wake up. It's okay. Maybe there's a slight rebuke even in what he says here. Like, ladies, why are you alarmed here? Don't you remember this is what Jesus told you was going to happen? And he has to remind them, you're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene, right? A confirmation that they didn't just go to the wrong tomb. They're not in the wrong place. Google Maps didn't lead them astray, right? They didn't get the wrong address, the wrong tombstone. They're exactly in the right place. They're in the place that they saw Jesus put in the tomb. They saw the stone rolled in front of it. They saw his dead body put in there. They're in the right place. And you shouldn't be alarmed. This messenger says, Jesus the Nazarene who has been crucified. It's just more confirmation here. Jesus, the one you're looking for, it's the same Jesus. The same one that was killed on the cross. The same one you witnessed die. And you witnessed him put in the grave. And now you're here witnessing an empty tomb. Now, skeptics throughout the course of history have given a host of explanations for what's gone on here. Many have said, well, they probably found the wrong tomb. Nope, that's not the case. Perhaps the body was stolen. Nope, not the case. Perhaps Jesus wasn't fully dead. Nope, we know that's not the case. And on and on and on these reasons go. But every excuse you could come up with is dispelled by the eyewitness account of these women and the information they receive from the messenger, the angel. And here's the phrase, the important phrase. He has risen. One simple statement that alters the course of all of history. This one statement reinforces the most important message in all of the Gospel of Mark. Namely, that Jesus indeed is the Son of God. He is the Messiah. He is the one that is come to fulfill all of Scripture. He is indeed the ransom for sin that he spoke about in Mark 10, verse 45. He is the one who pays for our sin. He's the substitutionary atonement for us. He stands in our place. He takes our debt so that we can be redeemed, so that we can be justified and seen as righteous before God. It's the same Jesus that they knew and that they followed throughout his ministry. They saw his authority. They saw the things that he did. It's that very Jesus who has also been raised. That's the message of the gospel, that the Son of God would die in our place and that he would become a ransom payment for your sin and for my sin if you repent and believe in him. That's the gospel message. And Jesus' resurrection attests to that, confirms that, and gives us a proof text for the reality that this is what has happened. You know, I just want to side note here. The NASB, the ESV both say he has risen, which is not a bad interpretation, but when we read that, we think it comes across sounding like Jesus just woke up all on his own accord, right? Now, he is risen. He rose from the grave by himself, but that's not really the case here. The Greek word translated really means that he has been raised. The indication is pretty clear that Jesus was raised not just on his own power, but the work of God is what raises Jesus from the dead here. It wasn't Jesus on his own. This is God the Father raising the Son back to life. Just make note of God's work here. His sovereignty over these circumstances. His sovereignty over this entire plan of Jesus' death and Jesus' resurrection. Verse 7, there's a commission given by this messenger. It's a commission from the Lord. A direct message from God to his followers. But go, he says, tell his disciples and Peter. If you remember, Mark is giving the eyewitness account of Peter, right? So that's why Peter is probably named here. So go, tell his disciples and Peter, He is going ahead of you to Galilee, which is exactly what Jesus said he would do, right? There you will see him just as he told you. So what are they to do? What do you do with this earth-shattering news, this realization that Jesus isn't actually dead? This mind-boggling realization that somebody you watch die and be put in the tomb is no longer dead but is brought back to life? What do you do with that message? Well, you don't keep it to yourself. You go and you tell. You proclaim it, right? Throughout the Gospel of Mark, every time Jesus would do things, do you remember what he would command them? He would do something amazing and awe-inspiring, and he would tell them, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. Now is not the time. All throughout the Gospel of Mark, don't tell anybody. Now is not the time. But now it is the time. What happened? Jesus accomplished on the cross the redemption of humanity through his death on the cross. And that is the message that you go and you proclaim to the ends of the earth, right? That's why we do things like this thing on Wednesday night where we hear about workers who've gone across the world into difficult and hard places and are sharing the gospel in a city where there's, they said, fewer than 50 known followers of Jesus in a city with millions of people. Why do you do that? Because they need to hear about the Jesus who died on the cross for their sin. They need to hear about the free gift of grace. They need to hear a gospel that doesn't include you earn your way to heaven. They need to hear about the ransom payment for sin. That's what his disciples, his followers are told to do, to go. To go. Verse 8, though, something happens. This is the unusual ending. They went out, and they don't go, do they? They fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had gripped them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Can you sense the disappointment in the ending? Does it feel a bit like one of those movies where you get to that climactic moment, and you think this is going to be that mission cry, right? They're going to go and head out from here and change the world. And they cower in fear and trembling. They don't say anything to anyone. It's a tough thing for us to look at. It's a tough verse to understand, I think, for us. Why does Mark end the gospel like this? Well, I think the reality is because this is what happened. Mark's not making this up. He's not trying to imply something. But I think there's a reality for us, is that the resurrection of Jesus, it causes us to make a response, essentially. You have to make a decision. When you hear about the resurrection of Jesus, you have to respond, and there's really only two ways of responding to the message of the gospel. You can either hear the account of Jesus, of his life, his ministry, his death, his burial, and his resurrection, and you can have a response of belief. You hear and believe. And what is a response of believing? It's a response of repentance. We see that consistently throughout the Gospel of Mark. That's a correct response to the gospel, is to repent and believe in Jesus Christ. That's one response. Or secondarily, you hear it and you reject it. You cower in fear and you reject Jesus. Now, there's a lot of implications with that, maybe. You might be asking, well, what about these women? What does that mean of them if they didn't do what Jesus commissioned them to do? Well, I will just note this, is Jesus is a gracious Lord. In fact, the very disciples who have abandoned him throughout his entire crucifixion scene, throughout this entire resurrection scene, they're nowhere to be found, are the very disciples that Jesus is seeking out. Jesus first called them to be followers as they were fishers of men on the Sea of Galilee. And he's going to go back to Galilee. He's going to find those same followers and he's going to call them back to himself. And there will be forgiveness. There will be repentance. So take heart. Perhaps that represents you at a time. Maybe you've cowered in fear of uncertainty. Maybe you've rejected the message of the gospel. It's not too late for you, friends. It's not too late to repent. But I wonder this morning, how do you respond to the message of the resurrection? That's the implicit question being asked by everybody. I'm sorry, I don't know if I'm... I'll try to be careful. Okay, that's the question being asked of everybody who reads the gospel message here. How will you respond to this message? In repentance and faith, or with fear and with trembling? Now, I just want to, just kind of a side thing here. I think we see in the life of these women here, that they're not just called to a devotion to Jesus Christ himself, but Jesus is calling them to a devotion to the body of Christ. They're to go to the other believers, right? They're to have communion with these other, community with these other believers, fellowship with these other believers. They're to do this thing, this going and this proclaiming the gospel of repentance. They don't do it on their own by themselves. It's a call that is given to us collectively as a body of Christ. And with that, it involves gathering as a body of Christ to worship Christ and to represent Christ to the world around us that is desperately seeking for hope in this life. And there's no hope outside of the gospel message. No matter what you are fed in the world, there's nothing that gives you the hope of a Savior who dies in your place. There's nothing that gives you more hope than the grace of God and his mercy. So I just want to point that out and ask yourselves here, are you somebody who's regularly in fellowship with other members of the body of Christ? Is that something that regularly defines who you are? I think you should examine your life and ask that. Do I have fellowship with the body of Christ? Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be a member here and here every Sunday, but I mean the body, right? Are you committed to the local church at some level? Are you committed to each other, to praying for one another, to caring for one another, to helping one another? Are you committed as the body of Christ to proclaiming the gospel to those around us? So while this ending, I think, can seem anticlimactic and maybe a disappointment, if we're going to be honest, after going through this entire gospel, you kind of hope for something with a little bit more, I don't know, pizzazz or something like that. I think it's intentioned. Because I think the intention is for us, as readers of the gospel message, to read and to ask ourselves, how are you responding to the gospel? What are you going to do with this message that you've read, that you've heard, that you understand? Mark's gospel, and I say Mark's, not that this is his gospel, but his account of the gospel message here, is the same as all of them, and it's a call to repentance. It's a repentance that leads to perseverance and leads to faithfulness, because ultimately, in the end, it is God who vindicates you from sin. So how are you answering that call, friends? I think there's a big question for us to think about when we look at the resurrection here. And the question is this: what is the purpose of the resurrection? What is the purpose of the resurrection? Next week is Easter, and obviously that's a Sunday where we pause and we think on the resurrection. So you kind of get a two-part Easter message. I'm sorry it worked out that way. But I want to ask this question this morning. What is the purpose of the resurrection? And next Sunday, we're going to look more specifically at the implications of the resurrection in our life. What is the purpose here? One writer said, the resurrection should inform our understanding of the cross. And I agree. You cannot understand the cross of Christ without the resurrection of Christ. The resurrection is the proof for us that Jesus indeed is the Son of God. Sorry, it's already up there. See, he's not just another Messiah claimer. It was not uncommon for people to claim to be the Messiah. It happened quite frequently in the first century. So they were rather skeptical when somebody came along and said, "Yeah, I'm the Messiah." There was no other who had rose from the grave. The resurrection is a fulfillment of what Jesus claimed. He is the Son of God. He is God's agent of redemption, which means that it is due to the work of Jesus that we are redeemed. He's the ransom payment for sin. You're probably sick of me saying that, but I just want you to grasp that. It is so crucial for us to really believe that in our life. Because if you're like me, it is so easy to start to depend on my own abilities, right? Yeah, we know that the gospel is a free gift of God, that it's not because of our works, right? You've probably read that in Ephesians. Maybe you have it memorized. But how quick am I to start thinking that somehow what I'm doing in the church, what I'm doing to help others, that somehow that's maybe getting me in good standing with God? It's not, right? It is Jesus' ransom payment for my sin, nothing else. With no resurrection, here's the reality. We are still in sin. When Paul writes his letter to the church in Colossae, he says this. Let me just read this and we'll finish up here. Verses 12 through 19 of chapter 15. He says, "Now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there's no resurrection of the dead? But if there's no resurrection of the dead, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is vain and your faith is also in vain. Moreover, we are even found to be false witnesses of God, because we testified against God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised." Now, here's the important verse I think you need to hear. "If Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless, and you're still in your sins." Do you hear that? If Christ has not been raised, if there's no resurrection, your faith is worthless. What we do here, week in, week out, worthless, meaningless, because we are still in sin. That's the reality of the resurrection. It means that our sins are paid for. Do you believe the resurrection? When you hear this message of the gospel, do you believe that Jesus is the ransom payment for sin? Does the resurrection produce hope in your life that is far beyond this life? A final thought for you. I think a response of faith to the resurrection leads to a transformed life. Is your life transformed by Christ? Are you devoted to Christ in all that you do? These are the words of Jesus in Mark chapter 8, a sobering word I want to leave us with. He says, "For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will also be ashamed of him when he comes in the glory of his Father with the angels." It's a sobering message, isn't it? Whoever is ashamed of me, I will be ashamed of. Friends, are you devoted to Christ? Have you responded in repentance? Would you pray with me this morning? Lord, we do thank you for your resurrection. And Lord, I have to admit in my own heart, my own life, it's sometimes hard to just embrace that. It's such a foreign thing for us to understand how somebody can be raised back to life. God, would you give us the faith to repent, the faith to believe, the faith to trust in you? Lord, I pray this morning that the gospel would be dear to our hearts. Lord, would it impact everything we do inside the church walls and outside the church walls? Would it impact the way we treat our families and our friends? Would it impact the way we live and work and play? Lord, would you be honored through our lives? Would you be glorified? Lord, I pray that we would be devoted to you above all else. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this morning we have an opportunity just to gather around the communion table together, and the men will come forward here and pass out the elements. And as they do that, I just want to encourage you just to take a moment, as I think music will be playing here, just to reflect on your own heart and your own life, and ask yourself these questions. Have you responded in faith to Jesus? Or is it possible that your response is one of fear and trembling? Ask yourself and examine your heart this morning. Be sure that you are right before God, before coming to this table. I encourage you, if you're a follower of Jesus, I welcome you to partake of the elements here. You don't have to be a part of this church. But if you know Jesus as your Savior, I just welcome you and encourage you to participate in communion this morning. Would you take a moment to examine your hearts together?